is someone who I met through John Cagg a little while ago, and I've wanted since then to invite him here. He's written or edited 10 books. The one that I've read is called On Inhumanity, Dehumanization and How to Resist It. I was inspired to read this by a particular chief executive a few years ago, and that's a dark joke, you're supposed to laugh, and or giggle nervously. And I think it's a really interesting question.
Yeah, you'd have to second one.
Oh, good. Oh, wow, yes, okay. Here's the latest, Harvard University Press. So many of his books are award winners, and he's often interviewed, and I won't take any longer, but except to say that I think one of the things that SFI should do as we get farther into the century is think about things like authoritarianism and prejudice and all of the forces that are tearing to seem to be on the rise again. And I think David's perspective on this is particularly important. So take it away.
Okay.
Well, thank you so much, and thank you all for coming. I hope it's worth to you the effort of coming to listen to me. What I want to talk to you about is really the culmination of approaching now 20 years work on this phenomenon of dehumanization. And I'm going to do my best to condense this into half an hour-ish, so we have time for discussion. But that may be a bit of a challenge, because it's not like you can, there are a lot of moving parts here. And if you just pull some out and throw them to the side, the rest doesn't work, right? They're all related to one another in an important and intrinsic way. So let's see if this works. That was not a promising start. Do we need to turn this around, perhaps?
Is that on?
Yeah, it's on. Oh, this is not a serious problem.
Well, do you want me to advance the slides for you?
Yeah. Yeah, here, so just take it. Maybe the battery's low or something. Okay, advance the slide.
How do I do that on the keyboard?
No, just do it here. The arrow.
Okay.
Right?
All right, thank you.
Okay, so first of all, why is dehumanization important? And I'll explain to you what I mean by dehumanization in a moment.
Do you mind me moving back 3 feet so I can see the screen?
Sure, sure. I was told I need to stand over here for the camera.
Oh, this will be working very well.
3 feet closer so Sid can't see the screen.
I'm using the keyboard to advance the slides because we couldn't get this to work. But anyway.
Okay.
Yeah.
So this is from an interview. Oh, go back. Who's in control here? So that's working now?
Uh-huh.
So just give it here. Okay, we've arrived.
Right, to where the seminar will now begin.
Daniel Goldhagen, political scientist. This is from an interview he did with a genocidaire from Rwanda. And this guy is talking to him about his attitude. Okay. Now we're really there. When he was hacking people to death with machetes. And he said this, he said, they did not know that the Tutsi were human beings. Because if they had thought about that, they wouldn't have killed them. Let me include myself as someone who accepted it. I wouldn't have accepted that they are human beings. I can't explain it. The only answer I can give is that it was like being in a fog, something like a darkness. So if we take this man's word seriously, as I think we should, he's talking about being in sort of an altered state of consciousness. He can't explain it. It's something like a darkness, which is the title of the first chapter, the introduction to that book, Something Like a Darkness. Okay. So what is dehumanization? That's a problematic question to answer, because even in the scholarly literature,
There are there may be 8 or 10 distinct, logically independent notions of what dehumanization is. I've listed several of them here with people who advocate those positions. We've got roughly half an hour, so I'm not going to go through all those. Just concentrate on this one. On my view, dehumanization is the attitude, so it's something that goes on in your head, of conceiving of others as less than human creatures. And I use this word creature very deliberately because I, well, think of the title of the book, Making Monsters. The most toxic, the most dangerous forms of dehumanization. The other is not simply seen as vermin or bloodthirsty predator or whatever, but as something monstrous and demonic, something that's not part of the natural world at all. And I want to explain to you my view about how that happens, how that comes about. So that's the ball to keep your eyes on. And I want to emphasize this because a lot of people get it wrong. I mean this quite literally. Dehumanization, in my view, is not merely a rhetorical practice. It's not the fashioning of metaphors. People who dehumanize others are literally thinking of them as less than human entities. Okay. So this is puzzling, right? Like, let's suppose you're all a bunch of Nazis, a bunch of SS officers. Hopefully there are no Nazis among you. And I'm a Jewish guy, which I am, if you hadn't noticed with my hand gestures and so on, my inflections. So you're looking at me, and if you've really drunk the Nazi Kool-Aid, you think of me as a subhuman, as an Untermensch subhuman. But how does that work? I mean, I'm bipedal, I wear clothes, I speak a language, I speak your language, I try to dress warmly when it's cold, as it is here. I was quite surprised how cold it is here. So what's going on there? How could you, Nazis, but sane Nazis, think of me as something subhuman? Well, very fortunately, there's a robust body of psychological research, which was formally kicked off in the late 80s, which is research into what's called psychological essentialism. Now, I want to get at that concept with this illustration. Anyone have a guess about what's going on here? Evidently not. I'm not going to wait too long. This is probably a 14th century painting. And those two guys are Jews. And one of them is stabbing something. What he's stabbing is the sacramental host. In the year 1215, Lateran Council, it became official church doctrine that the host was literally the body of Christ. not figuratively, literally. And in fact, the whole body of Christ was in every crumb of every host. Now, that doesn't look to me like a Palestinian Jew of 2,000 roughly years ago. It looks like a wafer, which is what it is. But the thinkers who were operating with this notion had a way of dealing with this. It merely appears to be a wafer. But what it really, really is, is the body of Christ. So there is this dichotomy between appearance and reality, which people had no difficulty accepting. The literature on psychological essentialism basically says this: we human beings are disposed to do two things. We're disposed to divide the world up
into what we philosophers call natural kinds, kinds of things which are objectively out there, independent of our practices of classification. And this is the important bit, suppose that what makes any individual a member of one of these kinds is not its observable characteristics, but something unobservable on the inside, which the two psychologists who coined the term psychological essentialism in 1989 called the essence. So, put crudely, you know, what makes a dog a dog? Well, not that it wags its tail and goes woof woof or anything like that. You know, on this way of thinking, what makes a dog is some kind of inner dogginess. And the appearance of a dog is merely symptomatic of that inner dogginess. So this helps with this first puzzle that I raised when I called you all Nazis, right? You can look at me and you can think, well, yeah, he looks human. Sure, he's outwardly human. But what makes him the thing he really is something unobservable on the inside. And that's why, although he looks human, he is an Untermensch, he is a subhuman. Okay. Now, if you think about it, psychological essentialism, as I've just described it, gives us an account of how one might see another member of our species as non-human, but it doesn't give any analysis of subhumanity. Subhumanity involves a notion of hierarchy. There are higher and lower kinds of beings. Now, the illustration there on the left is an illustration, I believe that one is from the 15th century, what's known as the Great Chain of Being. This was a model that was immensely influential for centuries and centuries. And what you see is a hierarchy of kinds of beings. God is at the top, because God in this framework is the perfectly perfect entity. And then we have the archangels and the angels and then human beings. We place ourselves, modestly place ourselves just below the angels. And then all the other kinds of organisms down to here, we've got some, you know, demons at the bottom. Now, there's precisely one scholarly book about this, which was written in the 1930s by a philosopher named Arthur Lovejoy. And Lovejoy argued that this was a distinctively European framework, which died out with the birth of scientific biology late 18th, early 19th century. It's a great book. I don't mean to diss Lovejoy. He's 10 times the scholar that I am. But there's some big mistakes in there. First of all, this hierarchical framework is not limited to European civilization at all. Right? We find it very, very widely distributed across cultures. And second, it hasn't disappeared. In fact, it's become part of our moral psychology. So if there was an irritating, you know, mosquito buzzing around this room, and you were to swat it, Chris, and I were to say, how could you do that? What are you going to say? Ah, it's just a mosquito, right? It's a lower entity. The crucial thing about this hierarchy is, of course, the higher a being is situated on the hierarchy, the greater are our moral obligations to that being. This is from a biology textbook, late 19th century, from Ernst Haeckel. And you see, the great chain of being hasn't disappeared here. It's just taken a different form. Here we have man at the top. Not human beings, by the way, man. This is Germany, late 19th century, right? And down to the most primitive organisms in this kind of hierarchical framework. Psychologists haven't studied this properly at all. psychological literature is very, very limited. When I speak to psychologists, I very often say, well, there's a topic for you. Please do it. Please investigate. Please investigate how this hierarchical thinking works. So I've not been able, unlike with the essentialistic component, I haven't been able to draw on a robust research tradition to make sense of this. I've had to just try and figure it out myself. So what do we have so far? So far we have the idea that if we put the two things together, in seeing me as a subhuman, what you are doing, if you are doing it, is attributing to me the essence of a kind of being that is lower on the hierarchy than the human. So now I want to illustrate this. So you see it's not talk. I want to use two texts. The first was published in 1680 by an interesting guy named Morgan Godwin. The Negroes and Indians Advocate suing for their admission into the church, or, you know, these 17th century titles that go on and on and on for a page. And then this tasteful little number on the right, Der Untermensch, was published by the SS Publishing House in 1942. These are supposed to all be menacing Jewish people, right? Those are the Untermensch. So let's start. There they are, Morgan Godwin, who wrote the first book, and Heinrich Himmler, who supervised the publication of the second. So let's take a few quotes. Godwin, now it's very important to understand, Godwin is reporting. He doesn't believe this stuff. He was a relentless campaigner against the dehumanization of enslaved Africans. So what does he say here? The Negroes, though in their figure they carry some resemblances of manhood, that's the appearance, the outward appearance, yet are indeed no men. But they're not really human beings. They just look human. And we can compare that to an excerpt from the other text. Not all of those who appear human are in fact so. Woe to him who forgets it. Again, we have the appearance-reality distinction. Let's pop down here. Africans are, he was told, creatures destitute of souls, to be ranked among the brute beasts, and treated accordingly. So in the metaphysics of the day, it was the possession of a rational soul which played the role of the essence. So they are creatures destitute of souls. They don't have rational souls, therefore they don't have a human essence. And here we have the idea of ranking, that's the hierarchical notion. And finally, although it has features similar to a human, the subhuman is lower on the spiritual and psychological scale than any animal. Jews are beasts in human appearance. Now, actually, it's very significant. Lower than any animal. We'll get to that if I can resist the temptation to say too much to you and eat up all my time. Okay. Is this cherry-picked? Of course it is. And I'm using it for illustrative purposes. It's very useful, both of these texts, for illustrative purposes because they are so explicit. But if you go through the historical literature, you'll find these sorts of statements, usually in less elaborated form than we find in these two texts. Okay. Now, there's a problem with the picture of dehumanization that I've just presented you with. In fact, there are two problems, one of which has been addressed by others. And the other, as far as I know, I'm the only one who's addressed it. So it's really pleasant to be the main critic of one's own work, to get the jump on embarrassing criticisms from others. The first one I call the problem of humanity, the one that's been addressed by others, or at least noted by others. It's nicely illustrated by this interview with a woman named Maria, who was a perpetrator in the 1993 Hadarani pogrom. Hadarani is a town in Romania, and I'll spare you all the details. Two Roma people were killed, one burned to death, one clubbed to death, and a dozen Roma houses were burned down by a mob. Maria is one of the perpetrators. This is from the Independent newspaper. She said, "On reflection, though, it would have been better if we had burnt more of the people, not just the houses. We did not commit murder. How could you call killing gypsies murder? Gypsies are not really people, you see. They are always killing each other. They are criminals, subhuman, vermin, and they are certainly not wanted here." Now, what I want you to notice is how she refers, sorry, I'm a bit dehydrated here. She refers to these Roma people both as people and as not people, both as human and as not human. And she flip-flops between them, sort of duck rabbit-like. So she wishes they had burned more of the people. The gypsies are not really people. They are always killing each other. They are criminals. Well, you have to be a person to be a criminal. But then they're subhuman, and then they're vermin. So, oh, thank you. That's very kind of you. So, people who've noticed this sort of thing use it to draw skeptical conclusions about dehumanization. They say, well, yeah, so if you look at this, they're not really, don't really think of these others as subhuman. That's betrayed by the references to them as criminals, as people, and so on. Therefore, dehumanization is just a way of degrading, of diminishing others verbally. It's not a real phenomenon. People like the Cornell University philosopher Kate Mann makes that kind of argument. I don't think it's warranted, as you'll see in a minute. So that's the problem of humanity. And this is absolutely typical. If you go to historical examples of dehumanization, what we almost always find is this kind of tension between describing the other as human and describing the other as less than human, as subhuman, as non-human. The other problem is the problem of monstrosity. That's a still from the 1941 movie, The Wolfman. The screenplay of this film was written by a guy named Siebmak, Kurt Siebmak. I'll tell you about him in a second. 1941, what was going on in 1941? Oh, I know, World War II and the Holocaust. That's not accidental, because that's Kurt Siebmak. His text of the screenplay has various allusions to the persecution of Jews in, well, not just Germany, and in Poland, all of the territories that Germany had already taken. And in an interview towards the end of his life, he said, "I am the Wolfman. I was forced into a fate I didn't want, to be a Jew in Germany." The movie's really interesting. There are gypsies in it. The Mark of the Werewolf is a star on the palm of the hand. There are lots of allusions to what was going on. So this guy felt that he was a member of a dehumanized population, as he felt that he and his people were represented as monsters. Hence the werewolf, the wolfman. But the Nazis thought they were monsters too, right? It's no coincidence. These are very typical pieces of Nazi visual propaganda of a dehumanizing sort. So the one on the left is a Danish poster, which translates, I believe, "rats destroy them." And what you see is not a rat. It's not just a rat. A rat might be really cute there, you know, nibbling a piece of cheese or whatever. That's an uncanny, creepy chimera, a fusion of human and rat. And same here. Die Judentanz, You know, Jews come in disguise. And again, we have this strange combination of humanness and subhumanness. These are monstrous images, right? And these are absolutely typical. Okay. Again, here is a demonic Jew. This is a Dutch movie poster for the German propaganda film. Well, in Dutch, it's De Eeuwige Jood, the eternal Jew. And I've juxtaposed it with a quotation from Joseph Goebbels. Jews are the son of chaos, the incarnation of evil, the demon who brings about the degeneration of mankind. So we don't, it's very important. We're not just dealing with thinking of others as vermin. We're dealing with the representation of others as dangerous, monstrous, demonic beings. There are forms of dehumanization where that doesn't happen, but that's my focus here and in this book. I think this is the most dangerous, most toxic form of dehumanization. Picture. This is Waco, Texas, 1893. There's a crowd there between 15 and 20,000 people, spectators to a lynching. The man on the, what's referred to in news reports as the torture platform, was accused of murdering and raping the sheriff's four-year-old daughter. He was a mentally disabled black farm worker, 27 years old, named Henry Smith. Just very briefly, because many people don't understand what went on in these spectacle lynchings, he was taken to the platform after being publicly displayed. His clothes were torn off. He was tied down. Red hot iron pokers were rolled up and down his body. Then his eyes were gouged out. I should have given you all a trigger warning for this, as we discussed, with the iron pokers. And then he was slowly burned to death. Then the crowd rushes in to take souvenirs, bits of bone, bits of charred internal organs, teeth, stuff like that. These were often handed down from one generation to the other. Right. Lynching, as it was practiced in the United States from about this time until 1930s, was extraordinarily, unimaginably brutal. And you might think, how could people do that? I mean, these are whole families and taking their kids, and there are people selling food. It was a carnival atmosphere. How could people do that? Well, if we look at news reports of these events, we find phrases like this. The victim is referred to as incarnate monster, a natural monster, the most inhuman monster known in current history, fiend incarnate, monster in human form. So we have this monster language, this demonizing language in these accounts in the press. Here's another example. That's clearly a monstrous image. Negro Rule, the vampire that hovers over North Carolina. This was a cartoon that inspired or partially inspired the massacre of African Americans in Wilmington, North Carolina in 1898. It was both a massacre and a coup. It was a biracial government, and the Democrats didn't like that one bit. And so basically they killed, we don't know how many people were killed. Some, as few as 25, as many as 300. Here's a contemporary account. It was a great sight to see them marching from death, and the colored women, colored men, colored children, colored enterprises, and colored people all exposed to death. Firing began, and it seemed like a mighty battle in wartime. The shrieks and screams of children, of mothers, of wives were heard, such as caused the blood of the most inhuman person to creep. Thousands of women, children, and men rushed to the swamps, and there lay upon the earth in the cold to freeze and starve. The woods were filled with colored people. The streets were dotted with their dead bodies. This is a contemporary account, eyewitness account. A white gentleman said that he saw 10 bodies lying in the undertaker's office at one time. Some of their bodies were left lying in the streets, up until in the next day following the riot. Some were found by the stench and miasma that came forth from the decaying bodies under their houses. Okay, so what's a monster? Believe it or not, there is an academic mini-industry called monster theory. And I'm particularly influenced in this by the work of a philosopher named Noel Carroll, who basically, he does aesthetics, he studies horror fiction. And I think dehumanization is horror fiction, actually, but it's real horror. It's real. It's fictional because, of course, people are people, but it's real horror. So what Carroll talks about in his wonderful book, The Philosophy of Horror, which is a real page-turner. Philosophy books are usually really boring, right? Really, really. This is really good. He says, monster has to have two qualities. One is the monster has to be malevolent. His term is physically dangerous. It's out to hurt you. Monsters aren't nice. But that's necessary, but it's not sufficient, right? Because there are all kinds of things that are physically threatening. The monster needs to be what I call metaphysically threatening. Now, there's a whole literature going back to the early 20th century pertinent to this, which is the literature on the uncanny. And I don't have time to go into that, but the book does quite a bit. Suffice it to say that an entity is metaphysically threatening if it's a combination, a fusion, of incompatible natural kinds. Think of horror movies. Well, think of the Wolfman. The Wolfman is a wolf and a man. Now, normally, that's not possible, right? You're either wolf or you're a human being, but the Wolfman is both. Zombies are both alive and dead simultaneously. You know, they're decaying corpses, but they have metabolisms. They want to eat your brain and stuff, and they walk around. It's this metaphysical threat, which is a very, very disturbing. Right? So monster has to have both. Now, what I want to tell you now. So my first book on dehumanization was published in 2011. And I didn't understand this business about monsters back then. Now I do. And what I found, to my joy, is that one significant tweak in the account I gave in my 2011 book, Less Than Human, addresses both problems, the problem of humanity and the problem of monstrosity. We're getting to the end here. To understand how this works, one more thing needs to be put in place, and that's the following. Look, this is something uncontroversial, scientifically uncontroversial. We Homo sapiens are ultra-social primates. There is no mammal. You don't have to restrict it to primates. There's no mammal that is anywhere near as social as our species is. And one of the consequences of that is that when we're confronted with another member of our species, we're so finely attuned, particularly to the sight of a human face, and even more particularly to the sight of a pair of human eyes, that, in my view, we can't help but see human. It is automatic. It is modular. Our brains do something very special with the visual processing of human faces. There's big literature on that, right? So we can't help but see human. Come on. But, well, let me get there through an analogy. Here's this table, right? And it looks like it is free of gaps. I was talking about this over dinner last night, right? But microphysicists tell me, no, it's mostly gap. It's a super gappy thing. All solid matter is super gappy. Now, I can't see that.
but I accept it. Why do I accept it? Because the physicist is supposed to know. The physicist is in that position of epistemic authority, so I defer to the physicist. I say, well, I can't see it, but I'll take your word for it. That's really important. But the problem is, the same pattern of deference obtains with respect to people who would have us believe that despite what our eyes tell us, despite the fact that we see human, these others are not really human. This is an illustration of from a textbook, a biology textbook. It's from 1877, textbook by Ernst Haeckel, who we met in an earlier slide. He was certainly the most distinguished evolutionary biologist in Europe in the late 19th century. And he's picturing apes here. What do we have at the top? A chimpanzee, a gorilla, at the bottom an orangutan, and at the bottom right, an African man. Right? Haeckel was a very extreme eugenicist, just by the way. He believed in extermination of these inferior subhuman types. Now, imagine, you know, we're in late 19th century Germany. Who are we to disagree with Ernst Haeckel? Right? It's rational for us to epistemically defer to Ernst Haeckel. And if we invest that sort of authority in, say, a Nazi race expert, it's the same thing. When you actually look at the history of dehumanization, what you find is it's a little bit more complex than this. This is like the cartoon version, right? But what you find is it's not like people kind of wake up one day and say, oh, those people, they look different, they act different, they must be subhuman. What tends to happen is they're ginned up by propaganda, by people in positions of authority and influence that want to get them to do terrible things to other people. So dehumanization isn't just an oversight, right? It's a product of powerful political forces interacting with a set of psychological dispositions. So here's what I think happens. The dehumanizer's mind is pulled in two incompatible directions at once. Automatic representation of the other as human, and deference to experts who represent the other as subhuman. And then what we get is this: two contrary representations, mental representations of the dehumanized other as human and as subhuman. Now, not as partially human, partially subhuman, as wholly human and wholly subhuman. And this accounts for the flip-flopping we saw in Maria's testimony about the Hadareni massacre, pogrom, and also the monsterization of the dehumanized other. That's my story. Thanks for listening. So I'm happy to give unsatisfactory responses to anything you might want to ask. A bunch of hands came up. Let's just work our way this way. Yes.
Thank you. That was great. I have a question. Obviously, there's, like, as you say, political reasons that might motivate this, but in terms of deference to the authorities who kind of dehumanize others, it seems to me that there's, like, how does one explain the original dehumanizing authority? What's going on in their psychology?
Yeah, and so there are a lot of questions which we can't answer. Certainly sometimes it's just a cynical move to get people to do awful things. But other times these are people who really believe. Mm-hmm. And there's a longer, more extensive historical lineage of dehumanization going on.
So, but again, there's too much in the account to specify in a talk like this. But I think this sort of influence works primarily when there's already a dehumanizing ideology sedimented into a culture, right? Once these things get sedimented into a culture, they're very, very difficult to extirpate. They can go latent, but they're ripe for triggering, particularly if the social ecology changes in such a way as to make people feel vulnerable. Right? Now, when I say, when I talk about epistemic deference, it doesn't have to be to some fancy person like Hegel or some popular person like Rush Limbaugh, right? It can be, you know, very distributed and very local. I grew up in the Deep South in the 50s and 60s. It could be your parents, your teachers, your pastor. These are all people in positions of epistemic authority as you're, you know, you're growing up and you're forming your ideas. But apart from that, unless we could gaze into the minds of those who produce this stuff, yeah, it's more speculative than I would like it to be.
Thank you.
Can I have reminders? Working around.
Yeah, so I think one of the scariest examples I see of dehumanization at the moment is coming from the war in Ukraine. So if you go onto Reddit, and there are like several like subreddits that you can look on, you'll often see like Russian troops described as like orcs,
yeah,
you know, from Lord of the Rings,
yes,
right? And but this also extends to like Russian people generally. I've got very intelligent friends who seemingly, you know, you fall into this kind of like narrative structure. And one of the things I hear from some Ukrainian friends are they're having a really difficult time discussing this with their families who are still there. Understandably, you know, it's horrifying. But how does understanding, having a greater understanding of dehumanization, does it give you any way to stop it from happening? Or like, I don't know, probably not, right? But
I think we can extrapolate a little bit. We can try, but like in Ukraine, the forces are so overwhelmingly powerful. I've written a little bit about the Ukraine thing in my Substack. It's a piece called Putin's Nazi Jews. I mean, there are certain, there are steps that could be taken to make us less vulnerable to dehumanizing propaganda. And there are a number of those. For instance, understanding what it is about ourselves that makes us vulnerable. You know, there's no vaccination for it. Dehumanization is very, 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 very often, in fact, I would say generally, tied to ideas about race and racialization. Now, as far as I'm concerned, the whole idea of race is a non-starter. It's an ideological fiction. If we could find some way to get rid of race, we would have taken a big step there. Understanding the specific forms of propaganda that encourage dehumanization is really important, both so we can be vigilant and so we can collectively recognize danger when it's on the way. But there are no magical solutions. In fact, one of the reasons I've been wrote my last two books is I'm very, very concerned about the social and political consequences of climate change. When we're going to have massive movements of people, and so it's just, I think we have to get ready for some really, really terrible things with whatever fragile tools we have to do that. So as Cornel West likes to say, I'm hopeful, but I'm not optimistic.
Me?
Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks a lot for this unsettling presentation. I'm just trying to think about what some normative takeaways might be from this research you've done. And, you know, today I think we see epistemic deference to elites, but to populist authority.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
and which in this instance we might say is Trump to name him.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of us think Trump is monstrous, but according to what you've told us, you know, Trump isn't a monster. He's a human.
That's right.
So does that mean, would you say that this means that individuals can be monsters, but where we should be very cautious is in the attribution of monstrosity
to
groups?
No, no one's a monster. No individual.
No one's a monster.
Hitler wasn't a monster. Himmler wasn't a monster. They're not monsters. They're people who do really bad things. And when we call them monsters, you see what we're doing? We're trying to distance them from us. We're trying to say, they're like a totally different kind of thing. Now, I'm nothing like that. But that's exactly the wrong attitude, right?
So what
we are all potential
monsters.
No, we're not. No one's a monster, right? We've got to keep that in the fictional category.
Okay.
But we are, at least in principle, all of us capable of either being complicit in or actually getting our hands bloody.
Yeah.
Terrible, terrible acts. And the monster talk is taking us away. I think we should look at these people and see them as holding up a mirror to us, to the rest mm-hmm. of us, showing us what we are capable of.
Going off of that, excellent talk, thank you. How would we say, I don't know, that kind of, I guess, relief from inner conflict and thought would go into this. I mean, I feel like, of course, there's obvious exceptions, but I feel like a lot of the demonization and dehumanization that we're seeing now is very ideological and
mm-hmm.
sometimes has nothing to do with appearance, often does. Mm-hmm. But how do you think, like, the modern popularity of conspiracy plays into this? Is this kind of ease from conflict? We just let go and say, I'll go with this one. It's easier to say it's the creepy, crazy version, the monstrous version, than a complex reality. Or is it more kind of expertise and epistemic deference on oneself? I am now the expert. I've decided this coven of five people that I met on Reddit know better than everyone else.
I don't know.
Okay.
That's a short answer.
Sorry to ask a really psychological question.
Well, you know, that's a question that is open to empirical investigation. It's not the sort of investigation that I've done, so I'm not going to bullshit about it. I'm going to go here.
Yeah, thanks very much. I think it might be helpful to reiterate something that you said at dinner last night, mm-hmm. which is that dehumanization is not the only path towards
absolutely
mass violence, atrocious
yeah.
violence. And I wanted to draw you out a bit more on that. So if it's not the only path towards atrocious violence, then what are the conditions under which you think it is the main driver of participation in mass violence? That's one piece of it. And the second piece of it is, given what we know about the social psychology of wielding violence, how do we disentangle whether this kind of, you called it ginning up,
mm-hmm.
dehumanizing happens beforehand,
yeah.
or whether having, for peer pressure or internal reasons, having wielded that atrocious violence,
yeah.
I now console myself by ex post believing that in fact they are monsters,
yeah,
subhuman,
yeah,
and so
yeah. on. So one of the real difficult things about studying this stuff is that it's methodologically extraordinarily yeah. difficult to draw firm conclusions. I mean, it's inevitably informed speculation, right? So with respect to the second part, mm-hmm. I've probably already forgotten the first. Oh, yes, I remember the first part now. The second part, yes.
Yeah.
Well, you know, we can look at a temporal dimension.
Mm.
So there are instances where it's clear the dehumanizing rhetoric is building, 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 building before blood is shed. I don't think it has to be a facilitating process. It can be a post hoc
mm-hmm.
thing. Sure.
of course. So I'm totally open to that. Mm-hmm. How do you figure out? I think looking at the temporal dimension is the only mm-hmm. way to draw conclusions yeah. about that. Paths to mass violence. Well, so if we think of our hyper-sociality as an obstacle to mass violence, and here's another piece which I didn't mention. Look, any social animal has to have inhibitions against lethal violence, typically to members of its community. And for most animals, that's the local breeding group. For obvious reasons, you can't maintain a social way of life if you're ripping each other's throats out, right? So there have to be these inhibitions. Human beings being ultra-social, we know for tens of thousands of years at least, we've been involved in, say, long-distance trade with other groups and so on. These inhibitions have to be especially powerful and especially far-reaching. It's actually, in fact, not that easy to get people to kill other people. And the act of killing is, for very many people, I'll be cautious, an extraordinarily traumatic experience, an experience that haunts them for a lifetime, particularly when it's up close and personal. So dehumanization is one of several solutions to that problem. That is, the problem being, I can see, because we've got these great big brains, right? And we can engage in instrumental thinking. And we think, gee, wouldn't it be great, those folks over there, like if we exterminated them, we'd get all their stuff, we'd get all their land, or we could enslave them and you know, exploit them and so on. So this is a between a rock and a hard place situation, right? The inhibitions plus the recognition that it would be advantageous. Now, being the clever primates that we are, over time, we develop various social technologies for disabling those inhibitions. Dehumanization is one. Or I should say dehumanizing propaganda is one, but it's by no means the only one. There are various ideologies, particularly religious ideologies, which have been extraordinarily significant in disabling these inhibitions. The use of intoxicating substances, which goes back, is very widespread, and goes way, way back to disinhibit violence. The use of mind-altering rituals as well. There are many pathways. And actually, the use of, from the 14th century onward, long-distance weapons. So in the 14th century, mm-hmm. it was the longbow. You didn't have to be down there exposed to the cues that might inhibit aggression. You can kill people from far away.
If I could just push you a little bit.
Yeah.
I mean, being the hyper-social animals that we are, we're also incredibly susceptible to peer pressure.
Sure.
From our nearest
sure.
peers.
Sure.
And I think that often drives participation in atrocious violence, even against people that I think of are people.
Yeah. I would agree with that. Yeah. And, you know, you don't have to not think of people as people right. to do terrible things right. to them. Though some people find it a lot easier than other people to
yeah,
do,
that's
right?
True. Yeah.
Yeah, and certainly peer pressure. So this is not meant to be some kind of an exhaustive account of the facilitating conditions for mass violence. Rather, it's taking one, I think, very neglected phenomenon and trying to eliminate it.
Yeah.
You're very close to me. I'm sorry I'm neglecting. I'll get to you.
So we look back at some of these situations that you put up, like the lynchings mm-hmm. and so on, and we think, God, how could people think that? Mm-hmm. And we think of all ourselves as more enlightened.
Mm-hmm.
But what belief do we have that, you know, like in this room, that 100 years from now, people are going to look back and think, how could they think of that?
Well, we use electronic equipment that requires substances that are mined by child slave labor in sub-Saharan Africa. We cheerfully scoff commercial chocolate, which is also produced by child slave labor very substantially in the Ivory Coast, say. We do all kinds of things.
How about like, quote unquote, dehumanizing animal intelligence and animal consciousness?
Yeah, actually, I think that non-human animals, it sounds paradoxical, but it's not, can be dehumanized. To understand that, we have to get into what does the human mean? What is it to attribute humanness? My dog is human. I think, in effect, the category human boils down to, it's a little, again, a little bit more complex than this, but this is good enough for now. It means one of us, our kind. So it's an act of identification, and it's extremely malleable. So there are Homo sapiens, which can be non-human, and there are non-Homo sapiens that can be human. There's no fact about humanness and non-humanness. It's not like some kind of, these are not natural kinds. They're categorizations based on our practices, our social practices, in my view.
Actually, my question is related to Melanie's.
Okay.
So it's I wonder how much this can be generalized on simply the difference between us and them, in the sense that it can be just my family, my tribe, my country, my religion, my species, or mammals, or we can, I mean, in the first theater play, RUR, where the word robot was coined, there was a character that defended the rights of robots.
Mm-hmm.
So since we have all this boundary that is extremely mobile, not only among individuals, but also the same individual can say, okay, for these things, I'll draw the boundary here, and for these other things, I'll draw the boundary all the way there.
Yes, that's right. But the form of boundary drawing is significant. So the reason I don't like the language of us and them, in-group, out-group, and so on, is it's too broad.
Mm-hmm.
Here, I'm concerned with a particular form of asserting categorical difference, right? So I'm an analytical philosopher. There are a bunch of continental philosophers. That's kind of us and them, but it's not the sort that's going to lead to genocide, right? Hopefully. I don't know. Some philosophy conferences.
They're not real
right,
philosophers.
It's,
what a good
I don't
philosophy.
Like that term either as an analytical tool. These are far too general.
How do you select case studies to inform your account?
Right. You would be surprised. Right. First of all, virtually all of the literature on dehumanization, I would say like 99% of it, is in social psychology. And it's pretty devoid of actual case studies. In the sense that I think you mean, the sense that I deploy. I think it's very, very important if we're going to study dehumanization to look at actual historical examples in their full context, right? And my gripe with the social psychological literature, apart from the fact that I think some of these theorists have gotten things dramatically wrong, just psychologically, is that there's a tendency to sequester the analysis to the human mind. But we have to ask ourselves not just what's going on in people's heads, but what people's heads are in, right? The social and political and economic and environments and so on. Now, when I started embarking on this, it was like there was nowhere I could go where these examples were laid out. So I had to read my way through lots and lots and lots of different literatures to find the odd two pages or even a paragraph that's pertinent. And that would guide me to looking more deeply into those particular cases. It was sheer luck. What I stuff. Nowadays, I kind of know where to look, and I have preferences about what sort of examples I want to use.
A related thing where you said you think the social psychologists are focusing too much on what's in the head.
Yeah.
I was wondering during your presentation why you talk about what's in the head at all, because the evidence seems to be mostly behavioral. So instead of conceiving of people as subhuman creatures, why not treating them as subhuman creatures?
Well, there are a couple of ways I can answer that. It's partially answered in the first chapter of that book.
Okay.
But if we're going to talk about human behavior, surely we need to consider the causes of human behavior. And if we're considering the causes of human behavior, we simply can't dispense with psychology, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think dehumanization, and I think there are very good reasons for it, is always enacted. In fact, I think it probably mostly isn't enacted. So in Waco, Texas, when Henry Smith was lynched, my guess from studying this period is that most of the people living there and around there viewed, particularly black men, this particular, the monsterization is very gendered. It tends to be males who are monsters. And 97% of the lynching victims were black men. I would be most surprised if they didn't have these beliefs. I think there's every reason. Just growing up in the Deep South, I know, you know, back in 1960, many people had these beliefs. They didn't lynch anybody, but they had these beliefs. So I don't want to, I think it gives us an impoverished account of dehumanization if we just look at behavior without considering the conceptual, the psychological backdrop, the cognitive biases that make this be, that facilitate these forms of behavior, and the social milieu. If that was at all satisfactory. I've been ignoring. Go on, sure.
Yeah, this last example of this public lynching, which is so fascinating in a way. Just wondering, so dehumanization is certainly part of it in this case.
Yeah.
But then there is more to it, some kind of public display.
Yes.
Making the other group feel fear.
Yes.
It reminds me almost of witchcrafts, witch persecutions, right? There was a woman was a monster now, yeah. Or, okay, whoever was this, and so it was also publicly done, and also persecutions of just people who were criminals, public executions,
right,
in most gruesome ways, or criminals,
yes,
before.
Yes.
So there is, it's some kind of monstrous concoction.
It is. It's a very complex phenomenon, mm-hmm, what's going on in cases like this.
I'm even aware of these examples of public lynching are prototypical example of dehumanization, or is it, it's an interesting, fascinating phenomenon, but it does not have to involve dehumanization. As you were explaining, dehumanization, somebody who is subhuman, our reaction is, do you want to just squash them? You just want to kill them and exterminate. I can see the mass extermination,
mm-hmm,
is a kind of rational,
no, the lynching,
reaction to
lynching
dehumanization.
Fulfilled lynching fulfilled a very important social function.
Right.
And an important economic function.
Right.
In maintaining what was in effect the re-enslavement of African Americans through acts of terror. Yeah. And it also had religious overtones. We were talking about that over dinner last night. Highly ritualistic. Yeah, it's really multidimensional.
Yeah, in this case, dehumanization helped, but it can happen. It has a social function even without dehumanization, I guess.
Yes, that's right. Yes, yes. I mean, one of the formidable challenges in all of this is we're dealing with really complex phenomena that require multiple perspectives. And the challenge is finding some kind of way of bringing these diverse explanatory and conceptual and theoretical vocabularies together to give a holistic account of the phenomenon that we want to understand.
So I know we're at an hour and people should feel free to leave. They should also feel free to stay. I guess one of the things that I sort of knew but needed to be reminded of, which I think you looked at in when you used the Nazis as an example, is that they were especially exercised about the fact that sometimes Jews didn't look very different.
Oh yeah, it was real.
And that means those Jews are even sneakier.
Yes.
And even more zombie-like or monstrous, that they have that essence, but that they don't have the outward markers. And that
They needed to have yellow stars to identify them.
Exactly.
My Jewish grandmother
had the palest of pale skin, the blondest of blonde hair, right. The bluest of blue eyes. She could have been a poster child for the Nazis. She was a Romanian Jew.
So I think that sort of drives home the fact that this can't be chalked up to, you know, this person has different skin color than me, or that I have a sort of natural biological or cognitive response to that. Right. It's it has to be constructed. The other thing that comes to mind, I apologize because this is much less monstrous than what you told us, but in Buffy the Vampire Slayer and in a number of other recent important works of Western literature, there's this really interesting turn of humanizing the monster and yeah. of, you know, and of having people who are, you know, explicitly at the boundary between humanity and non-humanity, former humans, things that are trying to become human, things that are partly human, et cetera, et cetera. And
masterwork, Shrek.
Yeah, there we go.
Very good, yes. Yeah. Things that would rather not be human, but you know, turned human by mistake. So
The Shape of Water.
Yeah.
Yes, yes, good. So I don't know where I'm going with that, but I find it very interesting that that showed up, and I'm really interested in the movie The Wolfman now.
Mm. That goes way back, like Hunchback of Notre Dame, Beauty and the Beast.
Mm-hmm. Okay, right. So I think it's an interesting turn. I don't know if it is helpful in the real world at all. But because there is also a pleasure in feeling your sphere of empathy growing.
Yeah.
And being challenged in that way.
Yeah.
And, well, it'd be nice if we were trained to appreciate that pleasure more.
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm not sure I'm going with that, but there you go.
I don't know where to take it either. So.
Great.
But it's very interesting.
I have a really concrete question. Your last slide, that demonstration where those guys were walking
yeah.
the slide, I am a man. So I was just curious, like when was it? It seems like late 60s. Where was it?
That was the sanitation workers' strike, 1968.
The which sanitation?
Sanitation workers' strike.
Where?
Memphis, I believe.
I see, okay.
Memphis.
Yeah. And you will note, if I had lingered on that, you would have noticed that there was one guy who was white.
Right.
And he didn't have the sign on.
Right.
Yeah.
He doesn't need one.
He doesn't need one, exactly. Yes.
I'm just wondering, I'm thinking of making a couple connections. I'd like to hear you briefly talk about the connection to the uncanny, because it seems like the origin of the word monster, if I'm remembering correctly, has something to do with warning.
Yes, it means to warn.
And
yeah.
I know the uncanny mostly through Freud's essay, where he tracks the morphology of the word uncanny.
Yeah, I used to be a Freud scholar. I'm familiar with
it. Right, so you know the definition comes completely in a circle, right? It's,
yeah.
So it's both the familiar and the unfamiliar, and that's what creeps us out when something, when we say
yeah.
something.
Yeah, so I actually think, I'm a real big Freud fan, but I think there is better work done at the time than Freud's paper on the uncanny. And in particular, I really, really rate the paper by a man named Ernst Jentsch. It was published in 1906, called On the Psychology of the Uncanny. Now, the uncanny is an English translation of the German unheimlich, which, at least the way Jentsch used it, isn't well captured by uncanny. It has a disturbing quality. So I like calling it creepiness. And there's a creepiness spectrum from kind of moderate creepiness to horror. And Jentsch argued, well, let me give you one of his favorite examples. He talks about figures in a wax museum. So you go into a wax museum and you see, God forbid, a sculpture of Donald Trump. And if it's done well, you're immediately taken. It seems like the guy's there. But then you look a bit closer and it's not quite right. It's the eyes are dead looking, the skin is waxy and so on. And that puts you in a position, Jensch argued, of not being able to settle on one or another interpretation of what you're witnessing. Is it a lump of wax or is it a human being? And Jensch argues, and you can see my debt to Jensch here, that as long as that ambiguity is present, we experience this feeling of creepiness, of disturbingness.
The uncanny valley.
The uncanny valley. Yeah. Yeah, so in 1970, Masahiro Mori, I can't believe he didn't read Jensch. He doesn't say he did. The roboticist, Japanese roboticist, tells this basically the same story about human-looking robots and prosthetic limbs, that as robots become more and more and more human-looking, we become more and more and more comfortable with them until they're almost there, but not quite. And then there's this precipitous drop in comfort, and we find them disturbing. And that's the uncanny valley. There's also other literatures that pertain to this. Most notably, in my view, Mary Douglas, the anthropologist, her 1966 book, Purity and Danger, where she argues, basically, it's a very confusing book, but it's brilliant, that all cultures have this notion of the natural order. And so there are categories of things. But as soon as you try to carve up nature into categories, there are some things that don't fit in. They're anomalous. And those things that don't fit in to the boxes are experienced as deeply disturbing, deeply powerful, right? I need to be managed in certain sorts of ways. That's yet another angle on the same insight that starts with Jensch, goes up in a different way through Freud, Mori, and Noel Carroll.
So Tom, and then also I see Michael Garfield has a question from Zoomland.
Okay. Well, same question.
Yeah.
Same question. I mean, the unheimlich. Freud points out that though it means, you know, that which is not from the home, it's actually the exact opposite.
Yes, that's right.
Which is the most intimate.
Yes, yes.
Secret.
In Freud, we find this combination of opposites as
right.
Well.
Yeah. So in in Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, you get this horrible, marauding, invading creature invading the family home who wants to have an incestuous relation with his sister.
Yeah.
And then lo and behold, this is exactly what the family always was.
Yes.
He's going to marry his sister Elizabeth. So the monster is merely an exteriorization, or, you know, in The Merchant of Venice, the Shylock doesn't look different from Antonio. At the trial, Portia says, which is the merchant and which the Jew? They look the same.
Yeah.
What is dehumanizing about him is that he practices usury,
right,
which goes against the whole metaphysic of the Christian order of natural oikos, you know, oikonomia.
Yeah.
Although it's actually the Christian economic structure could not work without usury. So again, he embodies the truth,
yeah,
the secret truth of their system. And, you know, this seems to play out again and again. Zombies is about, you know, Haitian labor relations and slavery. Mm-hmm. It's always to do with structures of economics and exteriorized or perceived an internal secret exteriorized and beheld as a kind of revulsive thing. And I wonder if, I mean, this seems a kind of important way of thinking about dehumanizing of others. If we scale up the idea of a house, an oikos, to the level of a country, a community, it seems to kind of, for me, explain lots of the rhetoric we're hearing in Britain and America about swarms, of invading swarms of migrants who are actually, in fact, the very labor force that make our house work.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, let's not Freud. Freud is great, right?
Yeah, Freud is great. Freud's my
favorite. You hear a lot of that swarm. I share with him a fear that as we move into the century and many people are looking for places that they can live because where they were living is no longer livable due to climate change, that I'm sure we'll be hearing that word swarm a lot from political leaders.
I'm going to sit down even though they
can. Yeah, okay.
I can scoop this chair.
House.
Right, yeah. Michael, do you want to?
Yeah, thank you. That was a great talk. I'm glad to hear this in this space. So I'm thinking about the etymology of the word monster, and it's historic linkages or, you know, connotations as like a warning, yes, you know, a sign, you know, an admonishment. And then, you know, former MIT late historian William Irwin Thompson talked about how in history, evil, in his words, is the annunciation of a new order. You know, he thinks about the way that one generation regards the next generation's music as noise because it somehow, it doesn't fit their training data.
Yeah.
You know, and so he talks about the monster as like, you know, Godzilla is perfectly natural in the Jurassic period. The monster because it's out of place. You know, and so I love the way that, and I'm just kind of inviting you to riff on this because like, I love the way that you're pointing to representational models and, yeah, you know, a clash or a dissonance between representational models as the source of this. And yeah, it just is just curious to me that it seems as though evil and monstrosity have something to do with surprise or, you know, a challenging of one's expectations, and that the surface area of surprise, as you kind of suggest in your concerns about climate change and, you know, the rearrangement of geopolitical borders and the movement of peoples, the surface area of surprise seems to grow as the quote unquote adjacent possible grows. You know, so I'm curious if you think that, you know, that simply due to issues of social and informational scaling, that this is actually becoming more of a problem in history than less as we modernize and become more planetary.
Yeah, and so starting with what you said and then riffing a little bit, probably in a very different direction than you had in mind, I don't know. I mean, that remains to be seen. The fact is there aren't enough people working on this stuff. And there's so many empirically tractable questions that arise. I mean, it makes some very, very, very good and very significant projects. With respect to surprise, I think what I called metaphysical thread is key here. So let's do a little thought experiment. Imagine that you were to cast your eyes down to the floor, y'all too, and what you saw was a hand, a disembodied hand, scuttling across the floor like a big spider. My guess is that this would fill you with horror. It would be very disturbing. But it's just a hand. Like you could kick it out of the way, you could stomp on it. It's not a real formidable thing. You know, it's not like Godzilla. So why is this so disturbing? I'm avoiding the word terrifying because I think it's a more complex emotional state that this would elicit. And I think it goes something like this. If a hand can crawl across the floor, then anything can happen. So it's a disruption of our conception of the natural order which we rely on to navigate the world, to make the world predictable. And when things violate natural kinds, this guy, I guess I would represent this as like a spider in a hand in one, they disturb, they transgress our notion of the natural order. And it renders us extremely, extremely vulnerable. So there we have the notion of surprise and the unexpected and the unanticipatable, not merely the unanticipated, the unanticipatable. I think that's really, really important for understanding this stuff.
There's an interesting, I mean, a lot of us have been feeling angst about things like ChatGPT-3.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, and we say with a great deal of confidence that there is no inner life, right? That there's nothing in there.
Yeah.
If it was a physical object on this table, many of us would be very tempted to smash it.
right?
Because of our worries about how it will kind of produce inauthentic but very socially powerful. All the things people were worried about. And so one of the interesting subjects has been is the Turing test still sufficient to, you know, welcome a fellow consciousness?
Right.
Make it, you know, we might think of it as one of us, or we might think of it as a terrible threat, but does the Turing test still make sense? Because it is about outwardness.
Yeah.
And, you know, philosophical zombies, things that manage to look outwardly like humans, but in fact have no internal state or internal subjectivity, are also very disturbing, and we're not sure if they exist. And,
yeah.
And I remember saying to someone, confessing to a moment of dehumanization, I remember saying that Trump sort of emits utterances but has no beliefs and desires.
Yeah.
Which, you know, I don't actually believe, but I was trying to denigrate him as a conscious or mental entity. And it was easy to think that he just sort of spins out strings of words that satisfy certain statistical properties, not unlike GPT-3.
Yeah.
And, you know, of course, I don't actually believe that about him.
Perish the thought.
So, yeah, anyway, these are some kind of local examples, which are.
Yeah.
I just saw something floating across the screen a few moments ago that I've been thinking about the entire time. So is it okay if I ask a second question just to amplify something?
I just asked a second question.
You're forbidden.
Okay. Yeah. I'm very curious as to how your argument would interface with Hannah Arendt's argument about the banality of evil. I think Paige raised that in the chat.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's a...
Oh, I didn't see the chat.
Yeah, that's a pretty interesting question.
Yeah, I'm not real comfortable with her banality of evil idea.
It sounded like that's what you were saying to me when you talked about holding up a mirror.
Yeah.
You know, something that appears evil is actually quite ordinary, well, because it could be one of us.
First of all, I have to confess, I find Arendt really difficult to understand. But my objection to her banality of evil is that, as Bettina Stagneth has shown, she was really taken in by an act. She was taken in by an act.
Sorry, I don't know what you're referring to.
The Jerusalem trial of
Eichmann.
I'm blanking. Eichmann.
Yeah.
Eichmann was a very, very, very passionate and enthusiastic exterminationist anti-Semite. We know that from all the interviews he gave in South America. And he put on an act on his trial. And Stagneth argues, and I find it really convincing, that Arendt, and she has the greatest respect for Arendt's Eichmann in Jerusalem, was somewhat taken in by him. I mean, there was nothing. But the part that's right, and the part that relates to what you said, grabbing a hold of banality of evil from another end, is that we shouldn't think of these people as cackling monsters. Right, as you know, like caricatures of villains, that's just wrong. That doesn't capture. I mean, if you look at genocides, generally, including the Holocaust, it's very, very often the case that those who perpetrate mass violence see this as a moral obligation, and they're trying to save the world. Trying to save the world from evil, right? They're not trying to do bad, they're trying to do good. And that was certainly part of Nazi ideology, for instance, and radical Hutu ideology in Rwanda, and there are various other examples. So if we mean banality in that sense, yeah, I'm with it.
Yeah, and I think that's how she meant it.
Okay.
But I guess one sort of saving grace I mean, as you said, partly in response to Caitlin's question, there's been a long history of the dehumanization of Jews with all sorts of pseudoscience behind it. And so one could be slightly optimistic in the sense that this does seem to take a lot of work to really get people to this point. And it does not seem, at least if your account is correct, it's not something that happens endogenously. You know, sure. all sorts of animosity between groups happens endogenously.
Yeah.
But this level of, you know, what you call dehumanization, it has to be worked on and put in place by, you know, people who think and write carefully and
yes.
and passionately and mm-hmm. marshal arguments and, you know, pass on occult knowledge and, you know, the, you know, I mean, you know, since Jews are so sneaky, our knowledge about them is also very occult and appeals to conspiracy theories and, you know, the protocols of the Elders of Zion and so on. Even when there isn't an active elite who's openly pushing this, then you can find it somewhere, and then you have the joy of finding this this authority that mm-hmm. you've discovered for yourself and mm-hmm. want to share with your friends. And
yeah.
So anyway, it takes work.
It does.
But of course, then the other point you said, which is less hopeful, is that once that work has been done, then it does seem astonishingly long-lived, these things that, and as you say, you use the word sedimented, they can hang around in society, maybe in less explicit forms, maybe in milder forms, but that can be, you know, I'm sure the people you grew up with, if you ask them explicitly, you know, are Black people, they probably would have said, oh, well, yes.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
You know, but then these other things, you know, they wouldn't have said something like, they don't actually feel pain when you know, which of course many people traditionally say about animals as an excuse to eat them, right? That there's
yes, and still in medicine, I mean, there's good research showing that Black patients are given less pain relief for identical injuries than white patients. So this was an idea that we can trace to at least the early 19th century,
right,
that Black people are relatively insensitive to pain, mm-hmm. and it's stuck around. Same with ideas about Black people's lung capacity. This goes back to Samuel Cartwright's, an American physician, who said that Black people have inferior lung capacity and therefore their brains don't get oxygenated. And that's why Black people are cognitively defective. And therefore, slavery is good for them because it makes them work hard and it gets those lungs going. Oh, and God. Right?
Jesus Christ.
So in there's a device called a spirometer used to measure lung capacity. It has a race setting button.
Wow.
And that's part of the inheritance of that tradition.
That is still there in
It's UK. Still there.
So you probably know the controversy around the GFR, the glomerular ruler filtration rate test for kidney function.
Yes, yes.
Has a correction, which after much thought has been modified but not removed.
Yeah.
And, you know, so one of my colleagues was, you know, her mother was having kidney issues and it was, you know, she was near the threshold, for instance, where, so if you think that Black people's kidneys are healthier than they really are, you might deny them
exactly
for a transplant. Although then I think later her mother had COVID, and then the funny thing was the same correction might have put her over the threshold to be allowed Paxlovid because that's hard on the kidneys. But so I think the history of this, I don't think it came from quite as dark a place as the spirometer you just described, but I don't know that for sure. My understanding is it came from initial studies that had a very small subsample of Black people.
Yeah.
You know, But then what does that mean anyway?
Well, generally speaking, who's
black? You know, who gets this correction?
Well, exactly. Yeah, and medical science has been one of the most retrograde areas in terms of holding on to these racial notions.
Yeah. Well, maybe we should disperse. But yes. So David, unfortunately, is leaving tomorrow morning, but he is here all day today.
Yes.
And tip your waitstaff, and thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you for making me work when you get to those questions.
Would you kindly, would you kindly inscribe this if I'm getting to keep this copy? Or is this a display copy?
This is your copy.
Thank you.
And I will. I've got a pen in that office there.
I want to tell you something that I could not say in public.
Yeah.
The Holocaust survivor, she was done last year in 1995. She inculcated those ideas, which is anti-Semitic.
Yeah.
She was so dark about
Understandably.
May I hear what you just said? May I hear what you just said?
Beginnings.
She would say, like, when she was feeling kind of glum about the world, like, scratch a goy hard enough.
And but you have your idea and you're still have half ideas for a second round.
I'm also thinking about, you know, people who, I guess, if you're a race traitor, or an N-word lover, or this sort of thing. If you are a member of the dominant group, you're a terrible, terrible person, but you're definitely still a person.
Yes.
And I guess, so one of the things about your framework, which is maybe empirically valid, is that unlike some of these stories from, for instance, Buffy, where, like, over the course of several seasons, people literally lose and then regain their souls. They literally cross back and forth over the boundary. I guess, do you know of any cases where somebody is demoted from humanity due to their actions or their beliefs, where they really, And I guess it's also interesting that if you want to carry out this dehumanization, then it's also extremely important to be against, for instance, interracial marriage, because if there were more people along this boundary, it would question this boundary.
Yeah.
Right? So not only is it horrible to think that your daughter might marry a subhuman, but it's horrible to think, my God, will my grandkids be human or not? That's confusing. I mean, so that's, but then there's this, you know, you are an anti-racialist, and I appreciate that. But of course, there's a lot of debate about if we deny these categories, are we making it impossible to fight prejudice? And what is it, you know, is the notion of blackness a notion which can do good, which I think a lot of our friends would say it is. Mm-hmm. I don't think the notion of whiteness is a notion that does any good at all, though. Mm-hmm. You know, so you have,
blackness can do good insofar as it becomes a vehicle of solidarity amongst at least a sector of oppressed people.
Right.
One might want to say, though, that a more extensive solidarity would be even more powerful.
Thank you for bringing him.
Sure.
Well, thank you. What was I going to say here?
Well, for instance, solidarity among the dominant group
gives us
liberals a huge sense of ick.
Yeah.
But then there are other questions like, well, yeah. So of course, what we would really like would be solidarity between poor white people and black people and so on. And
that was actually going on in Wilmington.
Uh-huh.
That was one of the factors that provoked the massacre.
I see.
It was something called the Fusion Platform.
Right, I saw
that. Poor whites and
That was the biracial government.
That's right.
Right. Yeah, we can't have that. And so, right, I mean,
So you have to divide the working class.
Right. You know. Yeah.
Yeah. So look, these racial identity, I see it. I like Paul Gilroy's work, which is, his views are really similar to mine. I guess that's why I like them. He talks about how these identities were thrust on people. I see it as a double assault, actually. First, racializing them, and then, in consequence of racializing them, legitimating their exploitation and brutalization.
Right.
But the problem is, in a society saturated with racial beliefs like our own, growing up with a racial identity is hard. I got lost in that sentence somewhere, but it's hard not to grow up with a racial identity if you're a member of a subordinate group. So that gets incorporated early on.
Right. And if that identity comes with a, you know, Glenn Lowry was talking about this, if that identity comes with stories of resilience, mm-hmm. And resistance and mm-hmm. and success, then there's a baby in the bathwater that you wouldn't want to throw out.
Yeah.
And the, right. So, you know, it's very complex. I mean, I guess I think the other issue, you know, like I call myself a sort of identitarian curious universalist. I mean, I still think that Enlightenment universalist notions are of universal rights are the right notions.
Yeah.
I also think that tactically and strategically, they're often the most effective notions. But it's also true, I have to sort of listen to people who say that sort of MLK approach, it's been how many decades, mm-hmm. and in many ways we haven't moved much at all.
That's right.
And so I have to listen to them and not be one of the moderate liberal allies that he was writing to from Birmingham jail about, you know, just be more patient. And mm-hmm. but of course, you know, it's one thing to say be more patient about, you know, I would not want anyone to be patient about making demands of power. But so, yeah, where am I going with this? But yeah, right, but I still, I mean,
it's really interesting,
like, you know,
I was listening to people's experience, people who are racialized as Black from abroad who come to the United States.
Like your wife.
Like my wife.
Right.
Many, many Jamaicans have this experience. Like, race may be different now, may not be, I don't know, but certainly for my wife's generation, and for some younger people, race is not a salient category. It was very thin.
Right.
It's like, sort of like saying blonde or tall or
right.
purely descriptive.
Right.
And they come to the United States. So a lot of people from Africa get this as well. And it's...
all of a sudden, it's considered the most important thing about them.
So I've heard so many people, including my wife, say, I became Black when I came to the United States.
Right.
Yeah.
And I mean, you know, this is why I like John McWhorter, and I mean, one of the most basic rights that everyone should have, I'm not sure Rachel Dolezal has the right to call herself Black, mm-hmm. but I certainly think that John McWhorter has the right to say that his Blackness is not important to him.
Sure.
You know, and of course, there are all sorts of ways in which McWhorter and I are essentially in the same demographic, right?
Exactly.
You know, academic and mm-hmm. well off and mm-hmm. et cetera. So I'm sure when he says that, it sounds wrong, to lots of Black people who are not
yeah.
in that relatively elite demographic.
Yeah.
And yeah, anyway, so of course it's ultimately, I guess there might be some philosophical problems with this, but certainly the pragmatic point of view is to say, well, it's up to those folks how they want to think about Blackness, and it's not up to me. And, you know, if it's useful to them, great. And meanwhile, I stand ready to be an ally whenever they need something from me and mm-hmm. blah, blah, blah. But I remember, like, you know, when my daughter was young, you know, of course we had, as any liberal middle-class academic family has, you know, various children's books about Rosa Parks or whoever, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I wanted her very much to view those things as belonging to her. You know, she's a child. All of humanity and all of its achievements belong to her.
Yes.
Not just.
Yes.
Yeah. And, you know, so I remember there was somehow it came up. I don't think it was, it didn't actually happen, but it was like, well, what if she wanted to dress like Harriet Tubman mm-hmm. for Halloween? It's like, oh, that would be great, honey. It's like, okay, here's a coat and here's a wig and, oh, wait, you want to put some brown on your skin?
Yeah.
Actually, don't do that. And so it's all this fucking, all this angst then.
Mm-hmm.
You know, now, of course, this is not the most important question compared to the immiseration and of large numbers of people, but it's, it did make me realize that if in her school it had occurred, which I don't think it did, but has mm-hmm. occurred in some non-zero number of schools, you know, you, little girl, are Black. Tell us what it's like to be a Black little girl.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you, little boy, are European.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us what it's like to be a, you know, and, you know, that's what you are.
Yeah.
And let's embrace our individual identities. We in it, as opposed to like, that's not. We're just yakking.
Oh, I was attending. Hello.
Okay. Hi.
My name is Veronica. I was attending from remote.
Good. Oh, okay.